Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers. Hey, we're at our new location, 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Avenue. We would love to have you. We are located at Gillespie Park Elementary School. We're doing a new thing. God has a vision for us to increase, step up, and step out in ministry. We look forward to seeing you there.
And amen. You may be seated. May be seated. Amen. Amen. Down a little bit. Amen. Amen. So, if you're writing down a title for today's sermon, I'm trying to do this fancy on my on a little tablet thing. Amen. So please forgive me. Change your surroundings. Change your surroundings. Change your surroundings. Change your surroundings. Amen. Amen. Remember when we talked about prayer not too long ago? And we talked about prayer, and we talked about the importance of prayer. And we talked about how in prayer that, you know, we often say it, that prayer changes things. Amen? Anybody ever heard that before? Prayer changes things. And that's so true, because prayer does change things. But the way that that process works is it's not that we should always look for prayer to change our surroundings, but that we should look for prayer to change us, to line up more with what it is God has going on in our lives. Amen? So when we pray, our prayer should be more or less to say, Father God, your will be done. Line me up with your will. Where I'm standing outside of your will, where I'm trying to do something that's contrary to your word, put me in the place that I'm supposed to be in so that I can deal with this situation. God might have allowed cancer to happen in your life so that you can be more focused on him instead of everything else. So if I'm praying for cancer to be removed, the very thing that God is using to help me to be focused back with, I'm messing it up. You see what I'm saying? So our prayer should be that to line us up with your will, with his will. So we're talking about change our surroundings. Change your surroundings. And we're going to use a similar principle in that changing our surroundings. When we change our surroundings, it's not necessarily that we should get up and move, but it's that we should have a different attitude about where we are. Have a different attitude about what we're dealing with in life. Have a different attitude about the situations that God is allowing us to go through. So by having a different attitude, we just changed our surrounding. Even though we were in the midst of a situation, we changed our surrounding. In our Bible study, we've been talking about the Apostle Paul and about how dynamic the Apostle Paul is. I need to use the hand mic. This is messing up. And the Apostle Paul is all of that. If you really take the time to study Apostle Paul, I'm telling you, you'll see there's a whole lot of stuff going on. In our Bible study, we were just only able to get to his first missionary journey, and we had a wonderful time in Bible study. Amen? Amen. Anybody have a wonderful time? Okay. Amen. So Paul is also the author of this 1 Corinthians that we're seeing. And Paul, in dealing with his surroundings and dealing with everything that was going on, one of the things that I love about the Apostle Paul is that he didn't let his situation deter him from still doing his job. Whether he was in prison, whether he was beaten, whether he was going through, whether he had all kinds of stuff happening, Paul said that, you know what, I've still been called to spread this gospel. And even though I'm in prison, I'm still going to write a letter. Even though I'm in prison and I'm going through, I'm still going to send for somebody else to go over there and to check on these folk. I'm going to make sure that I still do what it is that I need to do. Paul was one that in the Bible records that he had a thorn in his side, and he asked for God to remove this thorn that was in his side. He was saying that he wanted his situation to change. And God replied back to him and said, it's that thorn in your side, that very thorn that's keeping you, that's got you the track that I need you to be on, to do what it is you need to do. Here in 1 Corinthians in chapter 4, we see that Paul is writing, he's saying, look, there's some issues going on. And there's some folk that are Gentiles that were real caught up in how things looked. There were some folk that were real caught up in the possessions and the things that they had. And being so caught up in the possessions and the things that they had, they were missing the mark.
and what it is God would have for them to do. Look here in chapter 4. If you take the time to go through in your own study time and read through this whole chapter, you'll start to see that there's some things here in chapter 4 that Paul is referring to. And he said, I want you to look at it and I want you to see what's really going on. He says in verse 8, he says, now ye are full, now ye are rich, ye have reigned as kings without us, and I would God ye did reign. We also reign with you. For I think that God hath set forth us the apostles last, as it were appointed to death. For we are made a spectacle unto the world, and to angels, and to men. He says, we are fools for Christ's sake, but ye are wise in Christ. We are weak, ye are strong. Ye are honorable, but we are despised. He was showing the different contrasts of how folk were puffing themselves up as believers. Folk were puffing themselves up as believers to say that, you know what, we're sitting on top of the mountain. But Paul was saying, but you know what, as an apostle, as a servant of God, no, folk think that I'm crazy. Folk think that I'm going. He even goes on later on and to say in verse 11, even unto this present hour, we are both hungry and thirst and naked and are buffeted and have certain place. He says, look, as apostles, we're going through. We're suffering, going through this. But as believers, there are some that sit there in the church and put themselves up on a high pedestal. Change your surroundings. Even though he was going through, even though he had all kinds of stuff happening in his life, Paul said, I'm going to change my surrounding. I change my surrounding because of my attitude. My attitude is that, yes, I don't have a place to lay my head. My attitude is, yes, I am hungry and I am going through. But where I'm changing my surroundings is what's going on the inside. Because regardless of how much somebody else has or what somebody can look back and say this is their home and they have all of this, what's changed is my attitude about what I'm doing. I'm serious about what I'm doing, and I need to carry myself a certain way so that I can accomplish what it is God would have for me to do. So many times that's where we mess up. So many times when we look at a person that's an unbeliever, we're inviting someone to church, or someone comes into church, so many times people have been hurt by church and go through so much is because we act like we don't have any issues. We're not transparent to say, you know what, I really am going through. I really do have some stuff going on, but what makes it different from me going on before, now that I'm going on with Christ, is that regardless of what I go through, he's got my back. He's going to take care of me. And then we have folk that come into the church as unbelievers, and they say, wow, you know, those Christians, really, they really think that they something. They puff themselves up. That's what Paul was talking about here. As you continue to go down and you continue to read, now some are puffed up, as though I would not come unto you. But I will come to you shortly, if the Lord will. And will know not the speech of them which are puffed up, but the power. He said, it's not going to be about what I'm going to say to you. He said, but you'll be able to see the power. Why is it important to see the power? Ever wonder why God allows us to suffer? Ever wonder why God allows us to go through sometimes? How would someone ever be able to see the power of God if we never went through? If we are who we say that we are, we say that I'm a sold out believer. We say that, God, I love you. We say that, God, I depend upon you. We say, God, I lean on you. Then there's going to be some situations in your life that you're going to go through and you're not going to know how to handle it. But so that God's power would be revealed in your life, so that folk would be able to see that you have favor with God, he's going to allow you to go through some stuff. And as long as we go through stuff and we don't change our mindset, our surroundings will never change. Pastor, what are you talking about? Okay, here's a perfect example. If I'm going through a situation, and instead of leaning on God to help me with the situation, I try to get myself out of the situation. how am I showing the power of God in that? Because when I get out of the situation, you know how we do, we'll turn around and we'll say, I did it. Amen. But when we go through a situation and God allows us this situation to happen, and we say, you know what, God, I'm in a situation, I don't know what to do, I don't know how to handle it, I'm going to lean on you. I'm going to hold on to your promises. I'm going to pray about it, God. I'm going to hold on to your promises, God. I'm going to look up to the hills which come with my help. I'm going to hold on to your promises, God. I'm going to have faith that you're going to work it out. I'm going to hold on to your promises. And then through the situation, God works it out. And then we can stand and we can give testimony and say, I was in this situation, but I'm no longer in that situation, and God brought me out. That reveals the power of God. Paul sat here and said, for the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. But in power. There's another aspect that we need to look at when we say, you know what, I want to change my surroundings. Would you turn to James? James chapter 4. James chapter 4, verse 10. It says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. It says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Pride was killing the Corinthians. But we see here in James, it says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. You're going through a situation, you feel as though you're having a bottom of the barrel experience, humble yourselves in the sight of God. Stop being so prideful. Stop being in a situation and going through and being afraid to ask somebody for help. That could be the very thing that God is working with you on your life. He could say, I'm allowing you to go through this situation so that you'll stop always going through by yourself. So that you'll stop going through by yourself. Well, you don't understand. I'm used to having a certain look. Folk know that I don't go through. I'm the one that do that. Really? You go through. You got issues just like everybody else. Is there anybody in here, when you put on your pants, you jump into both legs at the same time? Anybody? Because when I put on my pants, I put on one leg at a time. I don't have the ability to levitate and just drop into my pants at the same time. I can't do that. We have the same issues. We have the same things that happen in our lives. And we have to be willing to share that with someone so that we can move forward together. Oh, Pastor, no. The Bible says that's what we should do. Look over in John, St. John. It's 13. St. John 13 and verse 34. Very familiar verse. John 13, 34. It says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. So if he's telling us as believers that we should love one another, when Brother Brian comes to me with the issue, it's not for me to stand in judgment of his issue, but it's for me to love him because God loves me. Because guess what? I got issues too. So as I sit here, I don't stand high up on the mountain. I don't stand puffed up. Brother Brian tells me that he has an issue, then what we're going to do is we're going to work on this issue together, and we're going to humble ourselves in the sight of God. Amen. There's nowhere that God doesn't see. We're going to humble, and he's going to lift us up. Amen. He's going, and I'm going to go through this, Brother Brian. When he needs someone for accountability, he can call on me. And when he needs someone to encourage him, he can call on me. And however I can help, he can call on me. That's how we're supposed to do that together. That's how we change our surroundings. We change our attitude. So Brother Brian can have a situation and say, well, I'm not going to call Pastor Webb. Well, I'm not going to call someone else. I'm not going to say anything, and I'm just going to go through it by myself. And a week turns into a month, and a month turns into a year, and a year turns into years. So now that Brother Brian now identifies himself with his issue, to the point that now his issue has taken over his life, so not only he identifies himself with his issue, now there's others that identify him with his issue. All because he didn't reach out to somebody else. All because he didn't change his surroundings, his mindset of how we deal with it. The church could be so much stronger if we would be willing to change our surroundings. Not necessarily our physical surroundings. There are some times that we have to change our physical surroundings. There are some times that we have to get up and move from one situation to another. But what I'm talking about today is changing our surroundings and how we think about what we're going through. Instead of me thinking about my glass being half empty, why not I think about it as being half full? Instead of me thinking about it, what I don't have, what about me thinking about it and praising God for what I do have? There's always going to be stuff that we don't have. There's always going to be something else that we say, gosh, I wish I could just make that next step. And we know it. When we make that next step, we get that raise. We get a raise on our job. And we're so happy about getting that raise. And then it starts to wear off. And we find out the person that's sitting beside us that's doing less work than we do and making more than we make. Now that raise don't look so good. And now we want to make another step. We get a brand new car. And once you drive around that brand new car for a little while, guess what? It ain't brand new no more. Maybe I scuffed a tire. Maybe somebody hit it with a car and dented it on the side. It ain't. And we want more. That's us. That's our human nature. So there's always going to be more that we want. But I'm here today to tell you that we need to change our surroundings. We need to change our mindsets and how we look at stuff. We need to change how we allow the enemy to get us thrown off track and not focusing on what it is God has already done in our lives. Let us concentrate on what we do have. Let us say, you know what? I'm going to not be puffed up. I'm not going to be prideful. I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to humble myself in the sight of God in my situation and say, you know what? Yeah, I'm pretty good at what I do, but I ain't all that. I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to humble myself and allow myself to be in a situation so that I can reach out to another brother, so that I can reach out to another sister, so that I can actually do what God has commanded me to do and show love and not be judgmental, not be so prideful, not be so puffed up. Paul, when he was talking to the Corinthians, he said in that last verse, look at it, verse 21, he says, how would you rather that I come unto you? He says, what will ye, that I would come unto you with the rod? In other words, that when I come, I should just be the disciplinarian. It should always be a beat down. He says, or in love. And in the spirit of meekness. Think about your situation. Right now, think about your situation. Now, God is dealing with you with your situation. How would you rather he come unto you? Would you rather God be the disciplinarian? Or would you rather him show you grace and mercy? I don't know about you, but I'd rather deal with grace and mercy. I'd rather him deal with me with love. And help me to get on to the next level. I'm going to change my surroundings. Amen? Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together for the Lord. In this study that I've been doing on Paul, I've read these books so many times before. I've looked at it, but God has just shown me some stuff that I haven't seen before, and I'm so thankful for that. And in doing this study, it's just really made me look at my own situation. And I know some people might think that just because you stand with the title of a pastor that you don't go through. It's not true. You do. Some people might think that because you stand as a title of a pastor that you don't have issues. I do. But in studying Paul, it's really helped me to realize that even the stuff that I go through, it's nothing in comparison to what he went through. And so no matter what, I just got to push through my situation. And not be worried about the title. Be willing to say, yeah, I got issues too. I go through stuff too. And not let the enemy try to keep me trapped in my own mind. Keep me bound up in a box in my own mind. Because that's how we do sometimes. We take our situation, we take our problem, we internalize it, and we put ourselves in our own prison. And nobody else knows it but us. Bible says that the truth shall make you free. I don't think he went to the cross so that we could be bound, so that we would be imprisoned in our own minds. Change your surroundings. You don't have to be what everyone else might say that you are. You don't have to be because of whatever issue that you're going through. You don't have to be whatever you think that you are. Change your surroundings. God has made us all individuals. He loves every single one of us. So much to the fact that the Bible doesn't say that when he went to the cross, he went to everybody that was over 6 feet. It doesn't say he went to the cross for folk that weighed a certain amount. It doesn't say that he went to the cross for folk that had certain physical attributes. He didn't say that he went to the cross for folk that were only a certain age. He didn't say that he went to the cross for folk that were only a certain color, a certain nationality, come from a certain culture. He said that he went to the cross for everyone. The Bible says that whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if he's able to do that, if that's what he went to the cross for, there's not an issue in this world that should be able to keep us bound. There's not one thing in this world that's able to keep us from thinking that we're unworthy. If we would just change our surroundings, change our mindset. They're talking about laying off of folk at the job. And folk are walking around and they're going, oh gosh, such and such is going to get laid off. Oh, what am I going to do if I'm going to lose my job? Kevin, you don't seem worried about it. No, I'm not. I'm not worried about it one bit. Well, you got kids at the house. Yeah, I do. But I'm not worried about it. If I get laid off, guess what? That means God allowed it to happen, and it's time for me to go. not going to let a situation bind me up. Because as the Apostle Paul, so you know where he wrote that letter from? He struggled going through himself. And instead of concentrating on himself, he said, you know what? I'm worried about them over there in Corinth. I'm hearing about stuff that's happening over there in Corinth, and I got to encourage somebody. Christ, when he went to the cross, he had the ability to come down. But he said, you know what? There's some other folk that's coming along. And I'm going to go through this. Because I'm thinking about them. Because I love them. Change surroundings. Amen? Amen. 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 It's personal decision time. If you, after listening to today's message, you've thought.
Thank you for fellowshipping with us here at Love Fellowship Believers. I hope something was said, something was done that really touched your heart, and God is starting to work and change your life for the better. We would love to have you to continue to come out and fellowship with us. We're at 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Avenue in the beautiful city of Greensboro, North Carolina. We're located actually in Gillespie Park Elementary School. We look forward to having you to come out and fellowship with us. Remember, God loves you, and so do I.